One day, in the presence of two other men, my husband looked at me and said, "Women all have the same motto, short and sweet." Overcome with indignation, I rose and hurried to my room. Louis noticed my attitude and followed me. "Ah," I exclaimed, "I do not know whether my life will be short, but certainly no one could say that it has been sweet." This was the first complaint that I had ever dared utter. My husband began to laugh. He assured me that such a compliment was not intended for me and that I was mistaken in applying it to myself. On the other hand, all his actions betrayed the fact that this was his real opinion. My fine natural constitution plus my youth saved me from those ills that almost invariably accompany a confinement which takes place under such conditions. But nervous troubles appeared about this time. I was no longer willing to nurse my child, as I was sure that after these various emotions, my milk would be unsatisfactory. It became necessary to relieve me of my milk, and this affected my head and my nerves. Sometimes I would come out of a long contemplation, alarmed at the fact that my mind had been completely empty. These fits of absence proved all too clearly how weak I still was. At such times, I would send for my little ones. I would look at them and convince myself that they still had need of their mother's care. I prayed that my courage might return and believed my prayer was answered. One day, the wife of Marshal Lan brought me her children. They were full of health and energy. I asked the doctor why mine were so pale. He replied, "These children are on a regular diet. Your son dines with his father, eats anything he wants to, and consequently his health suffers." My husband came in. I repeatedly gently said to him what the doctor had said, but he replied in a rage, "You never want me to have a chance to see my boy." And he left the room, slamming the door so violently that my bed shook. The nurse brought me my dinner. I tried to hide my emotion. I took a spoonful of soup but could not swallow it and swooned away. I only mention this incident because it had serious effects on my general health. For months, I was unable to eat anything. The moment I sat down at meals, the very sight of food made me faint. My only nourishment for a long while was a little dry bread with a little claret. The doctor could not understand my pulse at all. Dr. Corvisart said to me one day, "You are seriously ill, and I do not know in the least what is the matter. If you have any secret sorrow, confide it to me. Doctors are like father confessors. They must be told everything. Otherwise, they are liable to prescribe remedies that will prove mortal poisons." I answered that nothing was the matter. And as I spoke, I burst into tears. The doctor made no further inquiries and afterwards never made out another prescription, although he disapproved my conduct for the 10 years that followed. My husband's severity toward me continued to increase. He had forbidden me to go anywhere, even to see my mother without him. 6 months had passed since my confinement, and I was still unable to eat without fainting. Once my accoucheur came in before I had recovered my senses. He believed my nerves were responsible for my fainting fits and gave orders that I was to be taken out in the fresh air immediately. Madame de Boubers accompanied me to the Bois de Boulogne, where I met the Princess Caroline with her children and their governess. I entered my carriage. On his return home, my husband had not found me in the house. He did not know what had taken place, took a carriage and followed my footsteps. Unable to find me in the Bois de Boulogne, he became still more upset. Finally, he met me with the escort I have just described, but he never forgave me for having gone out without notifying him. This is another of his most serious charges against me. Perhaps my gentleness increased his irritation. That idea has frequently occurred to me since, but at the time I believed that it was this very gentleness which would cure him. Moreover, as I felt myself guilty of an affection that I was unable to stifle, I was the more ready to submit to his lack of equity. The question of a divorce between my mother and the emperor came up again about this time. A family council was called. The emperor's brothers displayed such relentless animosity on this occasion that Napoleon believed they were treating a matter of public interest as if it were a private feud. As a result, instead of heeding their advice, he made plans not only to make my mother empress, but to have her crowned at his own coronation. The Pope came to France to perform this ceremony, and it became the outstanding event of the day. People talked about nothing else. My husband went to Fontainebleau in order to be present at the interview between the Emperor and the Pope. While in Paris, His Holiness was lodged in the Pavilion de Flore, a corner of the Louvre, near the Pont Royal. I called on him, accompanied by my husband and my son. The sight of this venerable figure, head of the religion, which teaches the beauties of suffering and forgiveness, moved me deeply. I believe, had my husband not been with me, I should have fallen on my knees, imploring his holiness to give me courage, just as though such a thing were in his power. The Pope was everywhere, sought after, and treated with the greatest respect. He could see that the French Revolution had not been able to destroy here a religion which the now established liberty of conscience rendered still more inviolable. Every day in the galleries of the Louvre, an immense throng of people assembled to receive his blessing. Only one young man arrogantly refused to kneel, and his holiness passed. The Pope stopped and said to him very gently, "An old man's blessing never does any harm." Touched by his remark, the young man knelt in humble reverence. Thus, the gentlest religion can conquer human hearts. On December 2nd, 1804, we went in state to the Tuileries, and from there in a great procession to Notre Dame. The huge crowd of people who had gathered to watch us pass, the customary cheering, the presence of the head of the church who had traveled so far to attend the ceremony, the Italian cardinals, the army which had won so many victories, the presidents representing their different provinces, the foreign princes, the brilliant court officials, all contributed to make the spectacle one of the most imposing that can be imagined. My mother's grace and dignity won the admiration of all present. There had been violent discussions as to who was to carry the Empress's train. The Emperor's sisters had refused to do so, but were forced to obey or else not appear at all at the ceremony. The Princess Joseph and I were the only ones to play our parts willingly. As she entered the church, my mother mislaid the ring given her by the Pope, which he was to bless. His superstitious nature might have seen in this incident a sign of coming misfortune. My brother found the ring afterward and gave it to me. It is still in my possession. A few days afterward, the Emperor distributed his symbolic eagles to the troops on the Champ de Mars. At a cabinet meeting, the question had been discussed whether it would not be advisable to change the national colors to do away with the tricolor, which had aroused so much discord throughout France and which had been identified with so many crimes. But innumerable victories had since then made it a national rather than a party emblem, and the Emperor was the first to admit that it had been the symbol of France's regeneration, and consequently should accompany his eagles in order that they might be feared abroad and honored at home. The different ceremonies followed one another so rapidly that we did not have a moment to ourselves. In the morning, a number of Frenchmen and foreigners were brought to us to be introduced. My husband is Constable of France, had daily as his guests a number of generals and colonels. We also invited all the presidents of the French cantons. By a strange chance, a balloon that had gone astray during one of the fetes fell near Rome and brought to that city the news of the coronation 24 hours after it had taken place. My eldest child had been baptized by Colonel Caparra. The Emperor wished to have the one who had just been born baptized by the Pope. The ceremony took place at Saint-Cloud. It was the first time the Pope had ever performed this rite. Consequently, the greatest pomp accompanied it. My son cried a great deal. That was the only thing I noticed. Such a mark of the Emperor's favor vexed Caroline keenly. She had just given birth to a daughter and had hoped to have the child baptized at the same time as mine. I should have been glad to have this done on her account. The Emperor would not hear of it, and naturally she was rather jealous of me. These festivities, which the Emperor was obliged to attend, had taken his mind a little off his work. At least he seemed more willing to appear in society and to enjoy it. He had become courtly in his manners and spoke more frequently to the ladies, but only in order that he might the more easily converse with one of them, who appeared to interest him extremely. Madame du Châtel was about the average height with a good figure. Her features were animated and intelligent, her eyes large and deep blue with a charming expression. She had rather long and a very pointed nose, a large mouth revealing the most beautiful teeth in the world, a complexion that was dull in the daytime but dazzling in the evening. Such was the woman who disturbed my mother's peace of mind. Madame du Châtel had just been appointed lady-in-waiting at the palace. when she was at a ball. Prince Murat never left her side, but his wife did not seem disturbed. My brother told me one day that the emperor was in love with this lady. Duroc had mentioned to him that my stepfather was not attending to affairs of state as assiduously as he had done previously, but talked about her all the time. He added that Murat's constant attendance on her was not in his own behalf. We all of us feared the empress might notice what was going on. Had she done so, it would have wounded her cruelly. We all swore to help one another keep her in ignorance of it. The wife of Marshal Ney, who had always been a close friend of mine, was on duty as lady-in-waiting at the palace with Madame du Châtel. She had noticed to whom the emperor addressed most of his remarks and to whom he was the most attentive. My mother began to show an irritation which my friend feared would vent itself on her. I begged her, if the empress accused her unjustly, not to undeceive her, because it would be easy subsequently to prove her own innocence. Whereas, if my mother's suspicions were directed in the right quarter, she could no longer be in doubt and therefore would be unhappy. On account of her affection for me, my friend agreed to this, but always remained prepared to justify herself and declare the truth. My mother was conscious that someone was depriving her of her husband's tenderness. She became the prey of the gloomiest thoughts and became so profoundly sad that I no longer knew what to do to console her. I confided to Louis the reasons of her grief and asked him at the same time on that account to allow me to visit my mother more frequently. He acceded to my request, but only after making many objections. I frequently was a witness of painful scenes between my mother and the emperor. His wife's reproaches wearied Napoleon. He lost his temper. She did not attempt to hide her sorrow from her attendants, who consoled her and hastened to spread abroad the reason for her tears. The emperor appeared as a dangerous, immoral man. When these reports came back to him, he again became angry. In the meantime, my mother's grief, which was affecting her health, brought me to the point of speaking to Prince Murat. "You care for the emperor," I said to him. "Therefore, you ought to be careful of his family life. Instead of that, you are perhaps to blame for the fact that he and his wife are no longer on good terms. By repeating the remarks you hear made by people about the palace, you irritate him. His nervousness leads to renewed quarrels. This union, which till now has been so tender and close, is being broken up." Murat defended his conduct awkwardly. His only reply was that his devotion to the emperor was boundless. The next day, while they were out hunting, he repeated our conversation to my stepfather, probably changing it to create the impression he wished. A reception was held at the palace that same evening. The emperor came in, looked at me sternly, pretended to speak to the two ladies who were beside me, and passed me by without a word or even a nod. At the end of the evening, he could no longer contain himself. Whenever he was angry with someone, he was unable to conceal it. He called me to him, and the following conversation took place, the people who were nearest retiring to a distance to wait for it to be over. "So you too, madame, are against me?" "I, your majesty, I could never be against you." "Oh, it is easy enough to understand. It's your mother's doing. I cannot help thinking of and wishing for your mutual happiness. But you complain of the way I treat her." "Your majesty, my remarks have not been repeated correctly. You are free to act as you choose, but these scenes I witness between you and my mother make you both wretched. Those who provoke them do so in order to make themselves seem important. They are not sincerely fond of either of you." "Why should I not have friends that tell me the truth?" "Real friends do not try to increase friction between a married couple." "But your mother's jealousy makes me look ridiculous to onlookers. All sorts of stupid remarks are made about me. Don't you think I know about them? She is to blame." "No, your majesty. Those whom I am complaining about are to be blamed for it. If they tried to calm you instead of arousing your anger, you would be more considerate of my mother's feelings. How can you expect her to have more self-control than you have yourself? She suffers and she complains. That is natural enough. If those whom you consider your friends did not repeat her complaints to you, or if you were able to control yourself enough not to show her your displeasure, I am sure you would again be happy together. But I repeat, do not expect more patience from her than you have yourself." "You are right," said the emperor, suddenly becoming more gentle. "I realize that though I may be great in great things, I am petty in small ones." With these words, he left me. Several days later, he spoke about me in the presence of several persons. One of his remarks was so flattering, I feel I must record it. This was the sentence as it was repeated to me. Hortense reasons so clearly that one would think she is not influenced by her emotions. But when you know her well, you realize that her emotions are what make her reason so well. On another occasion, speaking to me of my married life, he said laughingly, Louis would have been happier with the Empress. One would have guarded the window while the other guarded the door. Becoming serious, he added, I know how irreproachable your conduct is, and I assure you, you are not only one of the women, but one of the persons I admire most. Such a remark coming from a man who was chary of his praise frequently consoled me for the injustice of others. Since then, I have remembered it with pride, and that memory has helped me bear the censure of which I received so large a measure. Although not so uncomfortable as mine, the Empress's married life was far from being a happy one. My mother began to discover who was occupying her husband's mind. In a short time, no doubt remained possible. One evening at Malmaison, she had complained of the Emperor's mood to the two ladies in attendance, who were Madame Ney and Madame du Châtel. The following morning, she said, looking at them severely, Ladies, it is most surprising that the Emperor repeated to me this morning a remark I made only to you last night. Madame du Châtel's color changed and no doubt was left in my mother's mind. Her grief was so violent that she succeeded in persuading the Emperor to break off his liaison. The effort was nevertheless a painful one, for Duroc told me, my brother and me, how strong an influence his love affair had on the Emperor. He was used to seeing everything bow before his will. Consequently, resistance increased his desire. But he had too much self-control to allow himself to become dominated by his feelings. Then also, he was too severe in his judgment of the private life of others to admit publicly that he was entangled in a liaison, and he did not hesitate to put a stop to an affair which is already causing him inconvenience. In order to be able to see Madame du Châtel and not arouse the suspicions of her husband, the Emperor, for several evenings, went out on foot alone with Duroc. Once he was taking a walk with her at Villiers, the estate belonging to the Murat, when they heard a noise. Afraid of being discovered, the Emperor leaped over a high wall at the risk of hurting himself. Duroc, not so excited, did not dare to imitate him. Constantly terrified to see him exposing himself in this way, Duroc was delighted when the liaison came to an end. I heard through Caroline that the Emperor sent Madame du Châtel his portrait set in magnificent diamonds. She kept the portrait, but returned the diamonds as she considered such a gift an insult. Caroline also told me that she had once been asked by the Emperor, when Madame du Châtel was ill, to obtain the letters he had written her. They were supposed to be extremely tender. Madame du Châtel was never willing to return them. I do not know whether they are still in her possession. People talked a great deal about the masked ball at the opera. What, said the Emperor, your husband has never taken you in a box to watch one of these spectacles? He really is too severe. You must go some night with your mother. One evening, after a large reception, the Empress, whom I was in the habit of taking back to her apartment, invited me to accompany her to one of these balls. I should have liked to have had my husband's permission. Although he hardly had spoken to me for a long time, I felt that for the first time he might now have a reason to complain of my conduct. I was unable to reach him, as he had already left the palace. The Duke of Vincennes, Caulaincourt, and Monsieur de Beausset had been appointed to accompany us. I kept beside Madame de Boubert. The sight of the masks amused me, but as no one accosted me, I was unable to understand why people found these balls so amusing. After we had twice walked around the ballroom, a man in a mask stopped us and wished us to go with him. What? He exclaimed. You indulge in an amusement which you so rarely have an opportunity to enjoy, and you do not know how to make the most of the occasion? You are nothing but a little fool. The man with the mask frightened me. We returned to the Tuileries. My mother was much worried to find that the Emperor was not there. A moment later, he appeared wearing a domino and informed us that it was he in disguise who had amused himself by frightening us, but that our hasty return had spoiled his plans. When I reached home, I at once told my husband everything that had occurred, but Louis made no comment of any kind. He no longer showed his disapproval of my conduct by reproaches as he had done when we were newly married. Now he indicated it by a chilling silence.